Hello, everyone, and welcome to our weekly video service at Shepherd of the Valley Lutheran Church. I'm Pastor Dave Deckard, and it's always good to have you here, especially on this holiday weekend, July 4th. We hope your celebrations are safe and you have a wonderful time together. Thank you for spending part of it with us. We're going to begin our worship time together by praying the prayer of the day. O God, you direct our lives by your grace, and your words of justice and mercy reshape the world. Mold us into a people who welcome your word and serve one another. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And we welcome the Lord among us today through the words of the Gospel of Matthew, the 10th chapter. Jesus said to the 12, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. And whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly I tell you, none of these will lose their reward." The Gospel of our Lord. Now in this Gospel, Jesus talks about welcoming. And actually, we need to stop right there for a second because our idea of welcoming is a little different than the one Jesus would have been talking about in his culture and his society. We're used to welcoming being a very casual thing. We say, "Hey, how you doing?" We expect the pat answer, "Well, I'm doing fine. Hey, welcome to the club. Come on in, blah, blah." If we don't want to interact any more than that, we don't have to. To the extent that we interact, there are prescribed ways to do it. And usually our welcome is set up in such a way as to provide a small connection of, you know, friendliness, peace, not hostility, but not force us to interact much deeper than that if we don't want to. That's not what the welcome would have been in Jesus's time. First of all, you would have lived probably in a small village in an agrarian society, or at least in close proximity to each other, even if you lived in a bigger town or a city. You would know the people around you, and basically you would not really have to welcome them because you saw them every day. The people you would have to welcome would be specifically people who were strange to you. You did not know if they were hostile or friendly. You did not know basically if they had grown up like you or were of your culture or maybe not, or sometimes it was obvious that they weren't, but that would be obvious. You would be able to tell right away, well, this person doesn't belong here. And it's not like they could say, "Hey," and then go somewhere else where they didn't see you, in your neighborhood, in your small village, in your farmhouse, whatever. If you were welcoming someone, you were going to be pushed into close proximity with them too. They would be drawing from your town well. They would be eating either around you or maybe at your household. They would be talking to everyone that you know, and they would have the power to affect your little community. And that was a much deeper, also a much scarier kind of welcome. There was no casualness. There were few prescribed ways to do it that kept you apart. Instead, you would be face to face, nose to nose, with another person, that you didn't know and maybe couldn't trust. When Jesus talks about welcoming here, he's talking about that kind of all-encompassing welcome that puts you at risk. That says, you know what, I have my way of life, I have my community, my prescribed way of thinking, but I am going to step out of that. I am going to open that up. I'm going to put that at risk in order to say hello to feed and provide water to, and to live among a person who is a stranger. And why do I do that? Not because that's necessarily going to be beneficial to me, it may not be. Not because I'm going to get something from this person, I may not. In fact, they may just move on. Not because I expect to remain unchanged, because you know what? In close proximity like this, people have an outsized effect on each other. And sometimes somebody comes to town, like Jesus, who says something that changes our whole world. And I risk doing that when I welcome them. But I do this because Jesus says it is better to risk all of that to welcome a stranger than it is to preserve what you have unchanged for the sake of yourself. Because, and this is critical, when God comes among us, God does not come among us looking like us. If all God had to deliver was exactly what we already had and exactly the way we expected it, there would be no need for a God. We would already be in paradise and we ourselves would be the rulers and arbiters of everything in it. If that were good enough, God could just leave us alone to be our own gods ourselves. But instead, when God comes among us, God explicitly changes us and changes the world around us and brings something new and speaks it in a new way and transforms everything so that we become more than we were. But this never happens if we will never welcome anything outside of ourselves. Inherent in the idea of faith in something beyond ourselves is the ability to welcome that something beyond ourselves. And that is why we welcome the stranger. And Jesus takes it a step further. He draws this connection explicitly in this gospel. He says, you know what? There will be a welcome for that stranger, because that stranger might be a prophet. What does a prophet do? A prophet speaks a word on behalf of God that changes your community, that leads you out of the path you were in that may have been imperfect or not as good as it could have been, and takes you to a new path which is more in alignment with what you were meant to be. And when prophets come among you and you welcome them, your security and comfort will not only be at risk, it will be lost, it will change. But you know what? Welcoming a prophet is the work of the faithful. And in fact, you can tell people are being unfaithful specifically by the fact that they reject prophets or only accept prophets who tell them what they already thought. That's absolutely replete throughout the Old Testament. It's one of the things that Jesus scolded people about, and Jesus is saying here explicitly, welcome the prophet among you. For whomever welcomes the prophet will be like a prophet themselves. Then Jesus goes on, also welcome the righteous. The righteous are ones who give goodness, who give rightness, who give something valuable to the community through their words and conduct. And you will never be able to define righteousness beyond what you already have, nor will you be able to experience righteousness beyond what you already have, unless you welcome righteousness in your community in new ways from new people. And Jesus says, likewise, whomever welcomes a righteous person will themselves be righteous. Jesus also calls the 12 among him his disciples. One of the places where he explicitly does that in the gospel. And we think, well, of course, they were the 12 apostles, they were the saints, etc., etc. Not at this time. At this time, they were just fishermen and tax collectors and who knows who from off in the sticks in the countryside. But Jesus says, you know what? I welcome you as disciples, as followers, as friends, as teachers, which would have been a revolutionary change in their status, a way of bringing them into the community with voice and power that they did not have before, which is also a way of welcoming. And he encourages the disciples to do the same for others as he has done for them, so that faith in God becomes a cascading, rolling welcome that goes out into the world, that explores and creates new ways of discipleship and righteousness and prophecy that we never would have expected, but that God is speaking all over the world if we would just stop for a second and hear it. And then Jesus makes one of the most revolutionary steps of all at the end of this gospel. After talking about prophets and equating his followers with those, and the righteous and equating his followers with those, and disciples and equating his followers with those, and saying whomever welcomed them would also be part of this. Hear the expanding definition? He made one more step. He said, you know what? Even a child in the midst of this welcoming, when a child is welcomed, or a child welcomes, then a child becomes like these things as well, part of the story, part of the discipleship and the prophecy and the righteousness, by sharing a cup of cold water. A simple act like that, that includes in the community more than existed before, by this God's word and God's intent shall be known. Even the kids, which is critical because, well, you know, in most societies, we have this idea that children don't know yet, that children aren't responsible yet, that children don't belong yet in the way adults do. And Jesus said, no, age itself will be no bar to participation. That the voice of the Spirit comes even through and among these young ones. So stop and welcome and listen. And the reward that goes to the greatest of prophets will be yours as you interact with these young ones. And if you are a child, you need not be silent or apart or wait for someday where you will have the voice and authority and power. Jesus, God, does not wait for someday to love you. God does not wait for you to fulfill a list of requirements before God speaks through you. God loves you and is speaking through you and has beauty and joy and life for you today and for you, as we always say, to share with the people around you. And God is not waiting for you to be 14 or 24 or 84 to understand it or to believe it or to do whatever in order to make that happen, as if it depended on you. God is giving this to you freely today, no matter who you are, no matter where you are, no matter how old you are. And so even the children are brought into this wonderful web of relationship in God's name. If your church has a youth group somewhere, think about how you may have spoken of them. Well, children are the future of the church. Or the children are doing this activity on this one Sunday. Or the children do certain roles in church and not others. And the most important roles are reserved for adults, but the kids can do a little something too. All of those things betray a basic putting off and mistrust of the children among us. The children are not the future. They are here. They are the present. They are alive with the Spirit and should be able to speak in their own ways and open up new ways of seeing God for everyone around. Children should not be limited to certain rooms and certain times and certain services. If we are not listening to the voices of our children, we are not listening completely to the voice of God. And it has not escaped my attention that there are a lot of grumpy adults out there in the non-church world who, as soon as they have figured out that Gen Z is going to vote different than they do or whatever it is, immediately moves to limit the voice and the vote of younger people, saying they don't know what they're talking about unless they agree with me. Hold on a minute. Maybe, according to this gospel, we don't know what we're talking about, and we don't have anything worth talking about unless we also welcome them as disciples, as prophets, as workers together in the kingdom of God, bringing new ideas and bringing new ways of seeing the work of God among us. I want you to think of all the ways that sneakily we want to limit God's perspective, God's work, and God's presence to ourselves. Welcoming radically, wonderfully, intergenerationally among all genders, orientations, all what have you, is our way of making sure that that little fearful voice inside of us that says God can only think like me does not have the central place in our personal faith or our community of faith. Welcoming is the great cure, the great opening up that allows us to be sure that we are gathering around God and not just ourselves. But we ourselves cannot tell ourselves that or be sure of it on our own. We need the voice of the stranger, the prophet, the righteous, the disciple, and the young in order to tell us and to show us the ways and the things we never would have discovered on our own. Think about how you might welcome the people in your life, share with them, nourish them, receive from them, and interact with them in ways beyond the superficial this week. And as you do so, know that every minute you spend doing that is a minute you spend discovering more about God and God's purpose for you in this world. Amen.
I can see the clouds rolling. I can feel the winds, they try to shake me. I will not be moved. My feet are on the rock. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands, our feet are on the rock.
Grace.
Having heard God's word, let us pray together. Lord, you speak among many people in many ways. Help us to hear the inspiration of your Spirit in the voices of our friends and neighbors, young and old, people of all genders and orientations, people of all backgrounds and races, people who believe like we do and people who think differently. Help us understand that none of us are inherently holy or inherently prophets, but that all of us change the world with our voice. Let us listen to each other respectfully and use our voices in ways that bring goodness to the lives of others. Bless us as we walk forward and celebrate our community in your name, and help us always to walk towards something good for your world. Amen. We invite you now to gather bread and wine or whatever you have on hand so we can celebrate together the sacrament of Holy Communion. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us pray together the prayer our Lord taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We invite you now to take the bread and the cup and to share them with the people next to you, saying, "The body of Christ given for you and the blood of Christ shed for you." And if you are watching this by yourself, know that God is with you, filling you with God's Spirit and love this day, every bit as much as God is with the people of this church or God's people throughout the world. And you may partake of the elements as I offer them to you. This is the body of Christ given for you. And this is the blood of Christ shed for you. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace, now and forevermore. Amen. We hope your weekend is wonderful and your week is blessed, full of inspiration, hope, and joy in God's name. If you ever want to come see us every Sunday morning, 10 o'clock in Boise, we worship. It's on the corner of 5 Mile and Victory, right behind the Maverick Station. Or you can always email me at pastor@sov-id.org if you want to chat. Until we meet again, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.